I wonder where it ever went, though. I never do see any of this stuff. I couldn't find this shit if it was in front of me.
So I guess the obvious place to start is the connection between Grandma and American Pie, because they're very similar movies.
Well, I tell you, they're both about people who are not willing to move on in their lives. And on some way, I feel like Lily's character in Grandma uses wit and anger to avoid sort of this sorrow that she has, where she has a long-term partner who's passed away. And yes, she's got a new girlfriend, Judy Greer, she's dumping in the beginning of the movie. And over the course of this day, she's brought face to face with huge things in her life. One of which is Sam's character, who's also, on some level, his character is had numerous wives, 11 grandkids, but still is nursing a love and a grievance over his relationship with Lily's character.
So is this the theme of your work that you're now telling us? Because About a Boy has
It's a trilogy.
Yeah.
We're all waiting to see what the next one's going to be.
If you buy that somewhat tenuous connection, then.
But I mean, is the unwillingness to move on and finding a way to do it really what you're interested in?
No question. Yeah. And as I sort of grow up, you know, the things that one has to move on from become deeper. Mm-hmm.
So how did this actually start for you? Because it's your own script and
yeah,
it's a movie.
It's it was I just had a movie come out called Admission, where Lily played Tina Fey's mother, and so I spent time with Lily. And then when that movie came out, I usually like to be on the set of another movie, so I have to think about the fact I have a movie coming out. But I wasn't, and sort of out of self-protectiveness, I went and started writing this one. I just did it longhand in a cafe, and the linchpin of the movie is this sequence that slingshots the movie into different terrain, which is the one that Lily and Sam have. It was the best case of a movie sort of writing itself, and I heard Lily's voice in the role. I didn't tell her I was writing something for her, because I was worried that she would be like, I don't know if I want you to do that, and then I would just stop. But then it was, you know, it was reassuring to her that people like Sam were willing to jump in and do it.
So it was a small part of the intention, or was that just a circumstance of what you ended up writing?
Yeah, that was the intention. I wanted to do something where my audience, honestly, really my audience, whatever I'm doing, is the actors. They're creating it, but they're also my audience. In this case, it was very clearly so. I wasn't really thinking what was going to happen with it. I wanted to not think of that, because I felt like all other aspects beyond the making of it are so out of one's control. And so I wanted it to be as simple as possible. And I think, I'm talking so much, I apologize. One thing that I find with actors of a certain level of experience is, I feel, and this could be horseshit, and you can tell me if it is, that they're actually getting closer and closer to what drove them to acting in the first place, which I find is so rarely about fame or success or money, and so much about loving acting and that act of empathy. So that's something that's exciting to me. Is that horseshit?
Horseshit.
Oh, yeah?
You know, the one thing about being around Paul is I think that his intellect intimidates me a little bit. I think I always feel that way when I'm around somebody that's really smart. It's like what he just said, it's so insightful. You know, the longer I've been at it anyway, I feel like I'm closer to some, the love of acting and the wanting to do it since I was like 9 years old consciously is what's made me get through it, survive it. And now that I'm still doing it at this point in time, I think I'm finally getting to the point where I'm really starting to act, finally kind of figured something out. You know, and if a good piece of material comes, that it's easier to do good work.
Have you seen a piece of material quite like this for you?
Never.
It does feel like a real departure.
Never. Never.
So what was it like to read that script for the first time?
It was incredible. It was incredible. I went right to the page first, which I think all of us actors do. I think it's, you know, it's like all about me, so I got to see what the fuck I'm doing. And in this one, particularly because it's segmented the way it is, mm-hmm. I thought like it was okay if I did that.
Yeah, you know, the character doesn't know what happened leading up to that.
Yeah, exactly. And then I looked at it in the bigger picture. I mean, I didn't have to go any further than the my sequence to know that I was going to hopefully be there, unless Paul changed his mind in the meantime, you know. But it's just such a gift to have great material and great people to work with. I mean, that's what we all want to do. And if we're fortunate enough, then it comes along.
So was Sam a voice in your head when you wrote, or was it something somebody you thought of later? Or
the menace of the guy was in my head. I mean, it's very uneasy. You don't know what their relationship is when they first get together, and the beginning of it almost is a little like a Pinter play or something, mm-hmm. where there's somebody, he's messing with Lily. Lily in the movie is this like extremely forceful character. And she comes in because she wants to borrow some money. And from the get-go, she's a little anxious. Like, she's not sure whether to bring her granddaughter in or not. There's a lot of other things going on. And as in a Pinter play, you don't know what the heck the source of the menace is. The great thing about Sam was I knew that he would put so much spin on it. Mm. I had this instinct that there was a potential for it to be really layered. I felt like Sam is the only person I thought of for it. It was just incredibly exciting when it actually happened. You know, we read through it, we had a chance to rehearse it, and I was really excited after the rehearsal, but still, I had no idea what it was going to be eventually, or how Sam and Lily were going to play off each other, and how much warmth was going to be implied, and also how much how wounded the characters would feel about each other.
Well, I mean, when you wrote this, did you think about, I'm not going to put in the things that a studio development life would put into this script? I mean, because one of the things about the movie that is like a Pinter play, in that it is very withholding,
yeah,
in a way that keeps you in the, you know, every second of the movie, you're trying to, even after you find things out, you're trying to figure it out because it's so complicated for her.
Yeah, I do think that there's a temptation, and I've never totally understood it. You know, one of the things when you do, as we didn't, a research screening, is one of the questions is there anything you didn't understand in the film? And nobody's ever told me why that makes something more appealing to an audience if they understand everything. I don't mean to be glib about it. There might be data that show if the audience is confused or doesn't understand everything, they enjoy the movie less. But it seems to be false to me. So that's why there's so much exposition in movies. In this case, once again, the audience for me was the actors. I didn't want to put anything in there that was going to be false. And actually, you know, at the same time, Sam is, you know, being very gracious and complimentary of the script. I really listen when somebody says the beat is false. And, you know, Lily's character has written this poem. The title of his chapter of this is called The Ogre. and you meet this guy, and is he an ogre or not? It's a good question. Or is she the ogre? But she's written, he brings up that she wrote this poem called The Ogre's Seed, which clearly was about him, and she claims that it's not. And I had a line in there where it was saying, like, where he says, oh, it was about some other ogre. And Sam said gently to me, but firmly, I really don't think that this is the right place for this line. I think you're kind of going for a laugh here, and we don't need to. And that's the kind of thing that I really listen to. Have the luxury of not batting an eyelash about when I've written the script and I don't need to worry about somebody else's feelings.
So when you started out back in going back to American Pie and all of that. I mean, you were a brother team, brother act,
as it were. Yeah, we did Ants together too, yeah.
And your brother has gone for, you've made studio movies, continued to make studio movies, but he's made like big studio movies.
Yeah.
He's gone for the big action and the big, you know, thing. Conscious on your part? Is that a different, is that where you, the two of you split in terms of the
kind
of work
you want to
do?
And actually sort of, we'd done About a Boy and happily we're always there for each other. We look at each other's cuts. We, you know, I have somebody in-house to talk to about how crazy things can be as a director. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to do another film of the scope of About a Boy, so I did this film called Ink and Company with Dennis Quaid and Topher Grace and Scarlett Johansson, and he wanted to make an epic, and I wasn't really interested in making an epic. So we were at that point where one of us was going to tell the other, you can't do this because I don't want to do it, and that seemed really unhealthy. So happily, as is not always the case, we're able to go and, you know, function on our own while still being really close. So that's been, look, and also, I mean, Sam had worked with Chris on Golden Compass and Chris had his phone number. So I said, hey, would you do me a whopping favor and call Sam Elliott? And Sam said he called him and said, my brother's not crazy.
Yeah, he said, first of all, I want you to know my brother's not crazy. What the,
that's the, sort what of, the fuck that's the high that? Standard that we feel like one has to meet.
Oh my God.
Well, we used to joke about that 9/10 of meetings in Hollywood were about whether the other person was crazy or not, or whether they're able to control their craziness.
Right.
And how often were you right?
More often than not.
Yeah,
probably.
It's pretty easy
to
find out.
I know you
It's pretty easy to find out who's crazy and who's going to make your life miserable. And then if you nonetheless work with them for whatever reason, that's okay. But, you know, the shark is not going to throw a beach ball with you. It's going to bite
right.
you.
So, but your work has continued to be the kind of movie they now say studios don't want to make and all of that. Is that, are you finding that true, or are you finding it more difficult to do the kind of work you want to do? I mean, this movie aside, because it's obviously very intimate and personal, but to make a movie that's a light comedy or a drama.
I'm not finding it difficult at all to make the movies I want to make. It's only if I have an unrealistic expectation of what the budget's going to be. And I don't care anymore. I think sometimes specifically about Billy Wilder and how in the last 20 years of his life he didn't make films. He had a lot of ideas for films. I was looking around for studio funding, and I know this because at that point in his life, my grandfather was his agent. Mm. He couldn't get a movie funded. Well, what if he'd been able to go do an independent film for $1 million or less, and I'm sure it would have kicked ass. Mm-hmm. Like, how many films weren't made because somebody interesting was didn't want to take that step? And those are people who I admire, Wilder, Lubitsch, etc., and I admire the studio film system, but I'm also living in a glory age when you can go make a film if you want to, and if you have a half decent reputation and actors are interested in the roles, they'll collaborate with you. So it's a joy to me. So,
and you're having the summer of people over 60 suddenly turning into a thing. Your other movie is kind of the hot movie of the summer in
it
terms
did
of
well.
Your house.
It did well.
And this one's looking like it's going to do really well.
I think it will.
Is it? Do you think people just kind of forgot to make movies for adults, and that's why?
I don't know. I don't know that it's a conscious thing on anybody's part, but I do feel that there's always been this tendency in Hollywood, or this, you know, call it a tendency. Paul would call it a number of different things, but, you know, driven by money and libidos, you know? I mean, it's, and give short shrift to those that are old enough to know anything. You know, I mean, I often talk about my wife when I get in those kind of questions, you know, who had her day, was the girl of the day. And now, you know, not working.
Yeah.
You know, but that said, I mean, yeah, this film, See You in My Dreams. I mean, last year, what's her name, won the Academy Award, you know. It's just, you know, it maybe it's time. Maybe it's time.
Maybe.
You know, I mean, certainly there's an audience out there. I mean, whether you're here, fucking the young males, 18-year-old bullshit. You know, that's somebody's captive audience or somebody's target audience. But you tell me that older people aren't going to the movies?
Well,
I promise you they are.
Scale makes a huge difference.
Why not give them some real stories and real themes and real characters? you know, some reality. A dose of reality is good for everybody once in a while, instead of this, you know, relying on these computer-driven fantasies. I mean, it's, they're all incredible and exciting, I suppose, but Jesus, somehow on some level, if you've seen one, you've seen them, at least for me, you know.
Did it feel that way 30 years ago when whatever genre was hot at the time was being made over and over again?
And like it wasn't Western? CG?
Huh?
Like the Western?
Well, the Western...
That was even longer ago.
Yeah, that was longer.
Yeah.
But they made a lot of different kinds of movies back then.
Yeah, the but the whole sequel thing, I mean, I don't think that was going on 30 years ago, no. Was it?
No, that kind of started with Star Wars. And
It's kind of weird in the current, with our election year coming up, with two major sequels potentially, you know, Clinton sequel and the Bush sequel.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see whether that happens.
Yeah.
I think it seems like people are tired of sequel. I mean, that's, I guess, the answer of the election so far, is that people are really interested in something different, even if they won't ultimately be elected.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard to cut through the clutter, so I understand the tendency to try to do something that people recognize the name of.
About a boy, the series.
Indeed, which I had nothing to do with, yeah.
Happy you didn't have anything to do with it, or?
No, I heard it was really good, so I'm bummed I didn't have anything to do with it.
So how was this unset? I mean, so this role different for you. Is it hard, or is it just that you're finally getting to do it? I mean, is it the same work as everything else you do for you?
It's just more fun.
It's more fun.
It's more fun when it's dynamic and there's more to it. You know, I mean, certain characters are pretty, you know, I mean, you see them and they don't have too many sides to them. Mm. You know, this guy was pretty convoluted on more than one level. You know, he was a troubled guy in some ways. I don't think that Carl was a bad guy, but, you know, I think that, you know, there's some of us that can go through life, I suppose. I'm not amongst them. But that they have their shit together enough where they deal with things as they come. And I'm done with that and move on. And it's healthy. And I think there's another percentage of us that, you know, tend to, if we can't deal with them, let's just get it out of the way and move on. You know, I think I'm somewhere in the middle there. I'm a centrist, basically, anyway, so I think I'm pretty much in the middle there. And I think Carl was that way. I think he didn't get over this, you know, this pain that he felt from this woman who ran off and, you know, left him for another woman, you know. And that was just one of their issues, obviously, you know. But the fact that this guy had multiple wives and multiple kids and, you know, multiple grandkids and for that reason, you know, had left all these fatherless kids out there, unless he was what, he was running around all the time taking care of all of them. He wasn't living with any of them or all of them.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of funny.
There's a great failing there somewhere. Sorry.
Oh, I apologize. But it was funny because, you know, you get the sense that he was something of a decent grandfather because
right.
He's got kids' toys strewn all over.
Right.
And at some point, he's pissed off at Lily and says, I'm going to go fix my Jeep. And we used the Jeep that my kids had. It was a little toy Jeep.
It was incredible.
That he's going out fixing the battery
it was
up.
Incredible. Instead of, I'm going to go work on the Harley.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
Some people, it's very funny because you think, and I thought when we did it, I thought, wow, this is going to be a fucking laugh moment. And Carl goes out and he starts fiddling with this battery and unhooking the battery for this Jeep. And then at the times that I've seen it, there's a few titters, you know, but I think everybody's so amped up at that point, they're not ready for a laugh. And they're just going with what's going on, you know. So it's funny how it goes.
Wanting to find out what's going on in his head.
Yeah.
And hers.
Yeah.
I mean, we know she wants money, but we don't know what really is going on.
Yeah, what's she doing there? Yeah.
So what's it like for you to have these kind of veteran actors to deal with? I mean, are you more reticent about directing? Or are you?
I'm not reticent. I just feel like it's very clear what my role is. Which is to offer ideas and to get the hell out of the way. generally, the actor, when they're that good, will tell you what they want or need. Usually they're interested in being directed, but also I want them to tell me when I'm doing something that's obstructing their performance. I want to not call cut before they're done with what they're doing. I want to I want to be a fan. I mean, I get to be the first audience for these performances, which is incredibly exciting. Then I want to make damn sure that I'm in the right shot. Because if that performance is happening in a shot that's not going to work for the film, that is not going to be the correct shot for the film, then I'm an idiot.
Is that an option on a budget like this, or you really have to get the right shot every time?
I think you have to, because I think that unlike theater where, you know, you're rehearsing in order to get it to a certain place and then there's a degree of repetition, in film I don't think you can have repetition. I think that it peaks, and then if it's peaking too early, people can tell me to go to heck, but sometimes I gently say, okay, that's getting too close, let's leave something. Mm-hmm. So you just want it to be captured while it's happening. It's the weird, it's a cruel thing sometimes, because it's only going to happen maybe once. There were, you know, but it's also super exciting.
So did you rehearse at all for this?
We rehearsed a bit, yeah. We sat down and read through it, but we did not go to where it was going to go while we were rehearsing.
So when you're on set at that point, you're shooting it and you're not really sure where it's going
to
go?
Yeah, that's right. To me, yeah.
And the thrill is just seeing it happen?
The thrill is getting sucked into it and forgetting what you're doing and watching it as if you're getting sucked into a movie. Yeah. And you're like, holy shit.
So that's a good answer for you. That's, you know,
yeah,
becoming irrational, yeah, or lacking rationality,
yeah,
is where you want to be.
I want to be prepared enough that I've done my homework, and then I just want to be free while it's happening.
And do you feel that as an actor?
Did
you
absolutely get that? Absolutely.
You just felt that kind of trust from...
from the get-go.
From the minute you found out he wasn't crazy.
That's right. From the call, from the phone call. You know, I mean, I was totally ready when I went in. I'm not a... I know some people, my wife's among them, you just look at a piece of material and just put it down, you know. I agonize over it. I agonize. And it's not like agonizing over memorization as much as I just want to squeeze everything out of it I can. I want to really spend a lot of time with it, and consequently I do.
So how does the partner
I think
affect
I overstudy, and I think that maybe is probably a fault in some level, but
when you add your partner to that, when you add Lily to that in this case, does it just change it, or are you...
No, just that's what allows it to flow free and, you know, full bloom. That's what allows it to mature, you know. I mean, there could be somebody in there that, you know, a different type of actor. Mm-hmm. When it's, you know, one of, as I was saying earlier, it's all about me. One of those, I've worked with a few of them before. Mm-hmm. They'll do everything they fucking can to throw you off. Mm-hmm. You know, instead of embrace you and bring it along, you know. Mm-hmm. This woman's a giver. She's a giver.
It feels, it's interesting, every time you think about her, it's, you know, that long history of,
yeah,
of the material, the stand-up and the, or the performance art, or whatever we want to call the early days.
Yeah.
But she really is a fine actress, and
incredible.
In this movie, it's, you really get to see it, I think, more than really anything else I think she's done.
Yeah.
I mean, she's great in a lot of movies, but this is really like a full thing.
That's incredible.
So did you know that when you wrote it? I mean, did you have that sense of, okay, I'm going to squeeze every part of Lily out of it?
I had some instinct, because I'd worked with her on a movie where she played Tina Fey's mom. Mm-hmm. And there are a couple of indications to me. One, obviously, spending time with her and talking to her. Unlike a lot of people who are very funny or comedians, sometimes you get a sense when you're talking to comedians that they're working on material with you. They'll tell you a really funny story, and then 10 minutes later, somebody telling the same exact funny story with a couple of variations in spots that you didn't laugh to that nice person. She's funny as hell, but it's freewheeling and it's responding to what's happening in real time. But then also, she, in this movie, she had to, in a scene, like she had to be fixing a bike during the scene. And so she was really laboring on how to actually fix a bike. She really learned how to, whatever you do with it, the chains on a bike and stuff. And then during the scene, she would keep doing it every time, even if it wasn't necessarily on camera. And then she also had to make sausage in this movie from raw meat. And I don't know why she just had to keep doing shit in this movie. But she took it so seriously that I was like, okay, this is somebody who, it's not about comedy, it's not about anything other than being in the moment. So I had this instinct that it would be great to give her the ball in that way.
So how hard is it to match up granddaughter in this case? Because that's a lot of role there, really, because she's working against that the whole time. She's Ginger Rogers, really.
Yeah. I knew that Lily had her foot, that her character had her foot on the gas the whole movie and had so many lines and so much, such a sort of virtuoso performance required, that I needed somebody who's going to be able to be in the scenes without as many lines and not be blown off the screen. Mm-hmm. And Julia has this, I think she's first off really interesting to look at in a sort of 1930s Jean Harlow, Betty Grable type way. And secondly, she's, it's really hard for her to do stuff that's false, which is a blessing and a curse, because if stuff is feeling false, that actor's gonna have a really hard day. They can't fake it and get through it. But it meant that in these scenes that there was always going to be something happening, even if she didn't have a ton of lines.
So when you finally got the movie done, was it, when you started to show it to people, were you feeling anxious? Are you at that point, do you kind of know what you have and feel comfortable that you're there?
Yeah, I felt anxious. The first time Lily saw it was also the first time you saw it. Sam came with Catherine and Lily came with Jane. And there's maybe a handful of other people in there, but I was really anxious about what Jane was going to think, honestly, because Jane is Lily's writer. She wrote Search for Signs of Intelligent Life in the Universe. And, you know, I was in her terrain here. You know, I wrote something for her muse. And, you know, I felt like if she didn't like this movie, I was going to be in some trouble. Fortunately, she's very gracious about it, as was Catherine. So that was the biggest audience to me. And the rest of it has been really exciting, like seeing it for the first time at Sundance in front of 1,200 people, and then also seeing it in Salt Lake City a couple of days later in front of 1,200 non-cineasts, seeing how it plays, that it functions as a comedy well, and that people will go along with it and have a good time with it, while feeling like it didn't I didn't shy away from any aspect of what the movie was about. It's been exciting.
So you get to relax after that? Do you ever feel, okay, now it's done and I don't have to think about it too much anymore?
No.
There's no relax.
I feel like there's the true drug. Everything else is a drug, but a slightly false drug, like sort of how things are received. Honestly, here's the thing. Like, this movie was very much, I mean, Sam, I obviously had a good time working with my brother and liked him, so that helped make you feel like it was going to be okay trusting me to do this movie. And there's a lot of other actors who I'd worked with before. The things which are not of the moment are the most exciting things. Like, the idea that, you know, Marcia Gay Harden, you know, when I sent her the script, she felt like she was going to, whatever, somebody told me that she was like, okay, I don't even have to read it, I'll do it. Those are the things that make you feel like you've done something right. Not having to do with whether something was good or bad or not, but I think that anybody who's done this for a while, you're trying to make things that are good every time. Sometimes it happens, sometimes it doesn't. I feel really great about this film aesthetically, but that's almost beside the point, because you're spending this time of your life on set and with this troop of people who hopefully you cross paths with frequently. That's the exciting thing. It's sort of a longer term, like, body of work type thing.
Mm. So this is just a step to the next movie, or the next.
Well, I think this is probably, you know, certainly one of the best ones that I've done. So it has meaning to me. It has meaning to me on a, in terms of my progression as a person, mm-hmm. Because it's a movie where the main character is lesbian. There's various issues, but it's a pure. In some ways, it's also got a lot of humor and it's hopefully entertaining. But it made me feel like I'd progressed as a person. I can identify with, you know, I identify with Sam's character in the movie. And the idea that time isn't a straight line, it's loops. You get thrown back into things. And the idea that, like, even though this guy's had numerous families, he has this treasure of something that's a thorn inside him. You know, he's got this little safe where he keeps cash and a picture of Lily Tomlin in it. I thought that was interesting and something I could identify with.
And do you carry around something like Down to Earth in the same way, or do you let that go?
Yeah, I mean, specifically, that's a movie that got really bad reviews.
Well, I remember I did a Q&A with you guys for About a Boy, I think, and you both apologized to an audience for having made the movie.
Well, I can only apologize for my own work on stuff. I think sometimes it's silly of me. I have a silly perspective. Honestly, Down to Earth, okay. First off, I met my wife on it. I wouldn't have been in New York at that time without that. Second off, I got to be in Chris Rock's playpen for a while. Not a playpen, I got to be in his world for a little bit. I shot at the Apollo Theater. I got to hang out with his bodyguard and his hairdresser, who were awesome people and characters. I got to spend time with Chris Rock. And while at the time, I think there might have been like a little bit of friction, now we're, I think, supporters of each other's work. And I learned a hell of a lot. And while I don't think that my work on it was any good, I still think that there's some validity to that movie, you know, mostly as a children's movie.
As a children's movie?
Yeah, I think so.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I have to go back and watch it.
Oh, please don't. Sorry, no.
Well, thank you guys very much. We're off to shoot Peter Bogdanovich, which...
Oh, cool.
Sam has some history there.
I'm working with a gentleman that's connected to Peter, who's I just met. I can't remember his name. I'm going to do this thing for Netflix. Mm. He's one of the producers on it. And we were talking about Peter. Peter's in town, apparently, now. And I'll give him my regards, if you would.
The circle keeps on going.
Yeah. There's another special guy, Peter. Mm. Incredible.
Thank you, guys.
Oh, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.